Welcome to the Kings of Sport, the program that's changing the game one show at a time. With your hosts, Nate Milton.
Yes! Boy, good!
And Marcus Vandenberg.
West side!
So sit back and relax, because you're now down with the Kings.
You guys not allowed. Nah, I'm just kidding.
What time is it?
My mentality was to go out and win at any cost.
Jordan is the most talented player in the NBA by far.
The show of the 90s, the team of the 90s.
How you doing?
Whenever they speak Michael Jordan, they should speak Scottie Pippen.
We created an image that people want to live up to. I think that's all you can hope for.
Welcome to the Kings of Sport, the program changing the game one show at a time, a.k.a. the world's most dangerous sports show, a.k.a. iTunes' longest-running weekly episodic program produced and hosted by two or more African-Americans who are not affiliated with a major network. We back, y'all, back for another week in our ongoing series, chronicling the last dance that, full disclosure, people, after the show, you know, Marcus and I generally tend to be quick on the uptake. We tend to be creative thinkers. But it occurred to me after the show that we should have entitled this whole series After the Dance, after that great classic DeBarge song, not only because it fits and it works and it ties into our sensibilities, but also because, as you can obviously see if you're watching the video version, we have a DeBarge in the house. So Marcus DeBarge, the long-lost, illegitimate adopted son.
Drug free.
yes. He's not visiting Chico in jail.
No.
But yes, this is the Kings of Sport. I'm the Godfather, Nate Milton, coming to you with these this new headset on. I'm getting used to it, so my voice might be louder or more modulated, because here's the thing. These are great headsets, but A, I'm not used to my microphone being on the left side. Like every broadcast I do, even if it's set up to be on the left side, I'll twist the microphone around and flip it so that it's always on my right side. So I'm doing a little Remember the Titans left side, strong side today. But the other thing is, like, my audio is severely decreased in the headset, but Marcus comes through clear as a bell. So I don't know how loud I'm talking.
I think you're talking the usual. You know,
yeah. Let's start talking like Chris Tucker in Rush Hour. And do you understand the words coming out of my mouth?
No, that would be racist in 2020.
Yeah. I was gonna say Rush Hour doesn't quite hold up.
No, it does not,
for a number of reasons, both on screen and behind the scenes.
It's no Bad Boys
with your man Brett Ratner.
Yeah.
So,
have we done intros? Have you seen the third Bad Boy?
I was going to say, like, I haven't even finished our intro. So, yes, Godfather over here. And then over there, it's Marcus, Mike Lowry, Vandenberg. All right, brother, let's talk about this Bad Boys.
So, I saw it last week.
Ah, the video on demand or whatever?
Yeah.
What'd you think?
Vince Russo wrote that movie, correct?
Hey, listen, bro. Here's the thing, Marcus Vandenberg. This movie was everything that you would think a Bad Boys movie made 10 years after the fact would be. Like, they're playing all the hits. You got your man Joey Pants as the captain. You got Will Smith doing Will Smith things 10 years too late. Martin Lawrence is Martin-ing it up. We've got these new kids that are, like, supposed to keep the franchise going. And, like, the only thing that surprised me from Bad Boys 3 is I thought Michael Bay did the movie, but no, it's like these young kids who just grew up on Michael Bay movies.
Wow. It was fine, but it was just the story, the plot line of it was just so absurd that really took me out of it.
I'm going to say spoilers for anybody that didn't want to be spoiled for Bad Boys for Life, but we're going to talk about it. But so it turns out Mike Lowry, all doing all this sleeping around in Miami, had an illegitimate son, speaking of illegitimate children, who comes back to be the top heel in the territory.
Yes, who is the child. How does this work? The second movie, there's a connection between the villain in the second movie, correct?
Yeah.
And the woman.
With Johnny Tapia.
Yes.
I don't know if she's his cousin or...
Let's see, what does Wikipedia say?
But yeah, like, it's very, very convenient and very, very convoluted.
By the way, no Gabrielle Union in this movie, which...
Yeah, a little...
Disappointment.
I wonder if she was ever supposed to be in the movie, or was this, because she had her issues with a couple of sets that weren't the most conducive and friendly and understanding of black women. The Americans Got Talent people, and it was another production she was on. So I don't know if these guys, I can't imagine though, because I can't imagine Will or Martin would let that slide.
So Isabel is the widow of Benito.
Okay. So that was like one of Johnny Tapia's crew.
Yes. So that's the connection between 2 and 3 is after Will, or after she had this child with Mike Lowry, she married this kingpin, this cartel kingpin, who was then killed by Mike Lowry. And then you find out that there's this secret son that is now trying to kill Mike Lowry to get revenge for, I guess, his stepfather. Got all that?
Yeah. Here's the thing about this, though, Mark. It's like, that's all ridiculous. And like you said, that's Vince Russo booking. But the part that actually worked in this movie, like Martin and Will Smith, it still works.
Yeah, that still works.
It still works. Like, they still got me with their interactions and their back and forth.
And then the ending of the movie where, you know, they capture this kid. And it's not a kid. He's in his 20s, probably. He makes it out alive, number one. And then number two, they tease that a potential fourth movie could be coming because...
Yep.
They keep the door open because...
Again, Nate, spoiler alert.
Nate, guess how much money this movie made?
That's a good question, Marcus. Obviously, it made a profit. I'm going to say... Oh, let's play a Rocky Maivia Picture Show rules. What was the budget?
The budget was $90
million. Budget was 90. Okay, I'm going to say it... I'm going to say 100 and 100. I'm going to say double, 180 million.
Nate, this movie made more than 1 and 2 combined. This movie made $419 million.
That's crazy. And that was before everybody got locked down.
Yeah, right before. This was January.
Wow.
$419 million.
Yeah, they're definitely going to make another one.
There'll be a fourth one.
Yep. And especially, like, again, spoiler alert, Joey Pants is no longer with the franchise. They took Joey Pants out, and now
R.I.P.
It looks like Will's going to lead the new the young kids.
No, the Rita's going to lead the young kids.
Yeah.
But this, you can write out Marcus's character because he wants to retire. So then you can have you can have father and son. Like, the son can be like the CEO, and then have Will or Mike Lowry as like the lead.
So you, I was gonna say, do you put Mike in the captain's place?
No, I think Rita's new captain. That, remember the very end of the movie? She just promoted.
Yes. Yeah. But Will will be like the kind of the field commander or whatever.
Yeah, we can make up a role for him.
Running out with these young kids. and there's still like a space. Like we can have a scene with Martin.
Yeah, he can make a cameo.
Yeah, it's like there's a space for that where Will needs help with something. And he goes to talk to Martin because the chemistry between those two still works.
Mm-hmm.
So. But yeah, Bad Boys. Like, I didn't know it made all that money, Marcus.
I didn't know it. I mean, I remember the promotion behind it, but I don't remember anyone really talking about it until, I mean, ever.
That's, look, that's Trolls World Tour money right there, Marcus.
Oh, here we go. At the very bottom of Wikipedia is, following the opening weekend box office success of the film, Sony announced plans for a fourth installment with Chris Brimmer returning to write the script. Okay. Yeah, we're doing a fourth one.
Yeah, so what you gonna do?
Yeah.
But real quick,
speaking of Bad Boys.
Well, again, I like that segue. Unfortunately, I'm gonna have to derail your segue because we of course are here. We're back to continue our series reviewing ESPN's The Last Dance documentary, which chronicles Jordan and the Bulls of the 90s. But before we get to that, Marcus, we need to do some follow-up for something we talked about 2 weeks ago.
Mm-hmm.
When you and I checked out the XFL website.
Yes.
To see what the prices on the jerseys were. And we need to give people an update. Are the prices still status quo, or have they come off of that dollar a little bit?
Let's see, DC Defenders Shop. We're checking the jerseys. And still same price.
Wow.
$225.
That is some nerve. That is how bold do you have to be, Marcus, to charge full price for a league that doesn't exist?
I clicked on the St. Louis Battlehawks jersey.
Mm.
Extra large, sold out. People are buying this crap.
Who? Why?
Who? For what?
Like, Congress didn't sign the CARES Act for you to waste your money on XFL jerseys, people.
Hey, man, you spent your check on headphones. People are spending their checks on XFL jerseys. Who are you to judge?
I mean, true, to be fair, true. You know, I got some headphones and a deluxe edition of NBA 2K20, so... I'm no better than you, St. Louis Blackhawks fan. Who are they, the Blackhawks, the Warhawks?
I don't know. I clipped out. The Landry Jones replica jersey that goes for $89. They only have two sizes left, small and 4XL.
I don't know any small XFL fans.
No. My guess is... You know, they did not restock once they started selling, like, in the season. So,
yeah.
I don't think people were buying it now necessarily. I just think people bought it during their 5-week run.
Yeah.
But that's the final.
I actually would have purchased some XFL merch if they would have came up off of that price. But, that's out of luck.
Yeah.
I wonder if that's going to ask how they pay him off. They just pay him an XFL merch.
They might. That's that lawsuit.
He just got a trunk full of XFL jerseys at the crib. Let's go from talking about some bad luck and talking about the XFL to talking about Michael Jordan, Marcus Vandenberg. and The Last Dance, parts 5 and 6 of this 10-part series.
Yes.
We watched it Sunday night. Of course, Marcus has seen it ahead of time, but he watched a long Sunday with the rest of the world because this thing is still doing numbers. Well, what did you think of starting with episode 5, which focused on kind of the rise and the business of Michael Jordan, you know, with the deal with Nike, which was a big thing, with, you know, the Dream Team and the 92 Olympics. And we got to Isaiah Thomas and Michael being petty with Isaiah. And we talked about the Jordan rules a little bit with Horace Grant being the locker room snitch, allegedly. We talked about how they did my boy Tony Kukoc dirty at the Olympics. So just on that first episode, episode 5, what did you think of that one?
And you forgot the intro, Nate. Rest in peace, Toby.
Yeah, I don't know how that slipped my mind, but yeah.
I mean, there's a lot in this first episode.
Yeah, we had the rest in peace, Kobe. Yeah, because by the time it's over, like that 10-minute opening scene about the All-Star game with Michael and Kobe, like that, like I'd forgotten about it because we'd gone through so much in that hour.
Yeah, Kobe opens this documentary, and they started with an In Memory of Kobe Bryant graphic. Yep. And they have this great footage from the 98 All-Star game at MSG where they're inside the Eastern Conference locker room, and these guys are just openly talking shit about Kobe and his, you know, shoot first mentality. This is the kind of content I wish we got more of in this documentary, where it was just unfiltered of guys just, you know, these are the conversations you never get to see or hear about. Especially hear about Kobe. It's just, you know, fascinating.
Yeah. Like, I think in terms of like that footage that you're talking about, Marcus, this might have been my favorite episode for that, because we had this stuff before the All-Star game, and then we also had the Dream Team practice.
Yes.
Which I hadn't seen before. And I like going back to that locker room talk, like I love how the way Michael and those guys are talking about Kobe. 10 years prior, you probably had people talking about Michael that same way. Mm-hmm. And it shows like the parallel between Michael and Kobe.
Yeah, and I think at some point, I think Jordan mentions, like, you know, since we're here, we might as well go win the game. So there's still that competitive fire within him for a meeting in this All-Star game that he won MVP for. So,
yep.
So yeah, and they interviewed Kobe. And once you watch the Kobe portion of this, Jordan's speech in February makes more sense of, like, I think people were a little surprised at the relationship,
and how
close they actually were. But when you watch this, it all sort of brings it together.
Yeah, that was a really interesting thing for me, and that was something I didn't know beforehand. Where you talk about, you know, when they were sitting down, and when Jason Ayer, the director, is sitting down with Kobe, and Kobe's basically like, you know, MJ was not only somebody that he looked up to, but he was somebody that he went to and just could talk to. Mm-hmm. And get advice on the game and on life and stuff like that. And I didn't, like, because in my mind, it was always Kobe chasing MJ. And it was not an adversarial relationship, but they were certainly competitors. And I didn't think that they were that close. Did you know, living in L.A., did you know, or did people kind of out there at the time have the idea that Mike and Kobe were actually that close?
I mean, I didn't. And I think part of that's because Mike is so reclusive at these days. Like, you don't really, outside of this documentary, there's not a lot about Mike currently that you sort of hear about.
And at the time, Kobe was very private too.
Yeah. So, I mean, that was a surprise to me, hearing Jordan's speech when he passed.
Yeah. And then it gives context to it, because when I saw Jordan give the speech at the memorial service, it was moving. Obviously, and it was heartfelt, but to me it didn't ring true, because I didn't know their backstory. I didn't know their history, and I'm not to say that I didn't believe what Michael was saying, but it just didn't fit the idea of Michael and Kobe that I had in my mind, and I'm sure the idea that a lot of people had in their minds about their relationship.
I mean, I think it's the same way with Kobe and Shaq, where they painted this image of a relationship that was maybe on again, off again at times, when it sounds like in reality those two are closer than the public even knew.
Yeah. So the first 10 minutes is kind of this nice interplay between Michael and Kobe. And then I think this is when we get the rewind and we go back and get into the segment talking about Jordan and his relationship with Nike. And we see David Falk.
Yeah. So they teed up with what would have been Jordan's last team at MSG. Mm. And he wears the Jordan 1s against the Knicks. And that sets up the story about how Jordan ended up at Nike. Jordan was actually an Adidas guy growing up. He wanted to sign with Adidas. Adidas couldn't get their shit together and was not in a situation to sign Michael. And it wasn't until Dolores Jordan, his mother, sort of forced him to, A, take the meeting with Nike, and B, sort of have an open mind about, you know, what they were going to present to him going into it. And he takes the meeting. They go, you know, basically court him, and he signs with Nike.
Yep. And it makes sense, like, looking back, that Mike would have been an Adidas guy growing up, because obviously in the 80s, particularly in black culture, like, we associated that with, like, Run DMC, and we associated that with hip-hop. Whereas Nike, as they say in the documentary, at that time, it was primarily thought of as just a track shoe.
Yeah.
You know, it wasn't a basketball shoe. And they showed the great clip of Converse, where Converse was the big shoe at time, where you had your boy Magic and Larry Bird rapping about a damn Converse weapon.
Remember those shoes, man.
Oh, man. I actually, seeing that, I was like, I kind of want a pair of Converse weapons right now.
They should bring them back. Like a limited
run.
They should.
Just bring Larry back to rap about him.
Yeah.
They should do like a deal, because you know, like Skechers has like Joe Montana and Howie Long.
Mm-hmm.
Converse should come out with like the weapons, but make them like, instead of actual basketball shoes, make them like leisurely athletic shoes for older people.
People wouldn't buy that though. You're banking on kids. You want kids to buy your shoes, not not old people.
Just have Larry Bird. I used to be bad when I'm on the court, but now sitting down is my favorite sport. That's all I got. I got no more bars.
All right.
did you hear I was listening to the after show with Jalen Jacoby, where they had Jason Aaron on. Did you hear where Michael almost went to?
For shoes?
Yes.
No.
And I don't know the reason why Jason said he couldn't put it in the movie, but there was some, maybe it was cut for time or whatever. It didn't fit the story that they were telling. But, and I don't even remember the brand, but he said there was a brand called like Good Pros or Pro Spot or something like that back in the 80s. And they had a spokesperson who was like, y'all need to check out this Jordan kid down in Carolina. He's a great kid, a clean-cut black guy, reminds me of myself. He'll be a great pitch man. And the current pitch man that was saying this at the time was none other than Twitter superstar Orenthal James Simpson. OJ wanted Mike to take his mantle at whatever shoe company this was and be the new black star.
Maybe that's why they didn't include it in the documentary.
Like, can you imagine how history has changed if Mike signs with OJ's brand?
I mean, they would make a killing, right?
Talk about a weapon.
Yeah.
Like, that was a great story, because I didn't know about, like, I've always thought Jordan and Nike were on the same page from day one, but to hear that actually, again, his mom, for the second time in this documentary, coming up in the clutch and be like, hey, Mike, you need to check out Nike and talk to him and see what's going on. Like, again, that changes everything, because Nike is not Nike without Michael. And you could argue that Jordan, he'd be a star, but Jordan wouldn't be as big a star as he was without that Nike machine in those early days.
Yeah, to this day, Jordans are still the most popular sneaker, and Jordan's been retired for 20 years. that, and I think long after Jordan's gone. Like, if they continue making sneakers, he will continue to be the top seller. Like, if Kobe or LeBron couldn't pass Jordan,
yeah,
I don't see anyone at the moment that is going to appear and have a sheet that is going to sort of be on that same level.
No, especially not Steph Curry.
Oh, no.
We've seen them shoes, fam.
I mean, the norm now seems to be guys taking more alternative shoe deals, whether it be like a lot of Chinese companies or even Puma getting back into basketball. Like, I think these guys know that there's only so many people at Nike that they can sort of market and build around, and you need to sort of look outside now.
Like, you know what's crazy, Marcus? You talk about Jordan and as a brand, like, that brand is so successful. Like you said, Kobe couldn't replicate it. LeBron couldn't replicate it. Shaq couldn't replicate it. Not even Jordan could replicate it when, remember, he had, like, the Jordan brand inside the Jordan brand with guys like, I think, Jeter. And he had the young guys that he was giving his approval to, and those shoes didn't really sell.
No. I mean, I think the Jordan brand, it's probably most synonymous now with maybe the college level of, you know, certain schools like Georgetown, Oklahoma are, you know, Jordan brand schools. And I think that is still a major pull for high school kids, knowing that you're going to be outfitted by, you know, Jordan brand compared to even just regular Nike or Under Armour or Adidas. So,
So then we go from there. We're talking about how Michael is just becoming this big star through Nike and the Jordan brand. He's got the deals with McDonald's and all this other stuff. And that leads us, Marcus, to 1992 and the Dream Team.
Yes.
With no Isaiah Thomas.
Isaiah somehow wasn't one of the top 11 players in the world at the time.
No, sorry.
Yeah. if you weren't sure that Jordan hated Isaiah in episode 4, episode 5, he let you know, I don't like this dude. I still don't like this dude. And I didn't want to play with this dude.
Yep.
But don't blame me, because it wasn't just me.
Right. Yo, when they showed a clip where he's like, I forget how he phrased it, but then whoever he's talking to is like, oh, yeah, that guy's not going to be on the team, the guy you're talking about.
He's talking about Rod Thorne. Rod Thorne called him.
Yes. Like, no, he's not going to be on the team.
Yeah.
Which, again, Isaiah's not a sympathetic figure here, Marcus, but he should have been on that team if we're just going by merit.
I mean, he should have been on the team, but they laid out, you know, Magic and Isaiah had beef. Bird and Isaiah had beef. Pippen and Isaiah had beef.
Yep.
At some point, you're spending 3 weeks with these people.
Yeah.
You don't like.
It's
like,
you know what? I'd rather hang out with John Stockton.
Come on, Christian Laettner. Come on. I mean, there's a certain level where it's like, I don't want to be around this person. And after this whole thing, I want an Isaiah documentary to examine why people hated this man so much. And what did he do to piss everyone off?
Yeah, it'll just be an hour of Isaiah sitting on the couch in his car dealership suit. Like, I don't know why people didn't like me, you know. I just was out there playing hard just like everybody else. And then 40 minutes of people just, I hated that son of a bitch.
I mean, you would based on this documentary, Isaiah is more hated than Bill Laimbeer. Like, and Laimbeer is like, I don't know anyone who likes Bill Laimbeer. No. At least Isaiah has, you know, defenders. But I mean, I'm glad that he was in this documentary. He got to say his piece, and that Jordan still slandered him regardless.
Yo, like the fact that Michael sits there and says, after Magic Johnson, Isaiah Thomas is the greatest point guard in the history of the NBA, but he shouldn't have been on the team. I like, like Mike. Just the level of pettiness, which brings me, Marcus, to,
oh boy,
you know, you said Scottie Pippen might make a heel turn in this documentary, and I believe the heel turn began in episode number five, where,
so before we get to, I think dive into Dream Team. Before that,
yeah.
Speaking of petty, the 92 finals.
Which, yeah.
You know, Bulls, Blazers. the comparison going into the finals was, you know, obviously Drexler v. Jordan.
Yep.
And Jordan uses as motivation that he was being compared to Clyde Drexler. Mm. And that seemed to be sort of the motivation for his game one performance, where he dropped 35 in the first half of game one of the finals, including six threes and the infamous shrug. I watched that game back yesterday, Nate, because it's on ESPN Plus. The interesting thing about that game, especially the first half, I mean, second half, he only had 4 points, but they blew him out. He was able to get so many open threes. It's like Drexler dared him to shoot the 30. And, you know, he shot, I think, 9 3-pointers in that first half, which is very uncharacteristic for Jordan at the time. But, yeah, I mean, I was more impressed by his short-range game than his three-point shooting. If he was, you know, 15 feet or in, like, he was pretty much automatic. And I think that is something that, in today's game, is sort of lost, because either people are shooting threes or shooting layups. There's no sort of mid-range game. But Jordan, you know, within the free throw line, was just deadly.
Well, I think that part of that, Marcus, is A, just because Michael was that great of a player. But B, yeah, they had statistics and stuff back then, but it wasn't as analytics-driven as the game is today, where they're like, why take a mid-range shot when you can just take a step back and go for the three? And that's how teams are being built. And so that, like, those mid-range players, it's kind of like the big man, like the classic center. It's an underappreciated art that is kind of being phased out in a way.
Yeah, I mean, I almost prefer that style of basketball compared to today's game, where it's just, you know, pull up three, long rebounds. Kick it out, another three.
Why do you hate James Harden?
I mean, I'm not someone who's anti-Harden in terms of watching him play, but I do think that the game overall is probably, it's not the same. It's definitely not the same as it was once in the 90s.
No. Now let's talk about this, Marcus Vandenberg. Right. We get the Dream Team. We get a lot of great stuff, like including that practice footage of the game that, you know, I guess Michael and Scotty and their squad was going up against Magic and Barkley and their squad, and they were losing, and your boy Magic is just taunting Michael, and then Michael comes back and just destroys them. And, you know, they're like, everybody's on the bus on the way home, and it's real tense and it's real quiet and nobody's talking. And then all of a sudden, out of nowhere, I think they said it was it Charles that said it or Larry?
It was Charles and Magic talking.
Yeah, okay, yeah, Charles is like, yeah, you shouldn't have been talking to that man. You shouldn't have got him started. And then everybody just started laughing. And then you see, like, kind of the camaraderie that, to your earlier point, might not have been there if Isaiah Lloyd Thomas III was on that bus.
Yeah. So as you guys know, probably by now, if you're longtime listeners, I was part of the Magic Johnson Foundation. And, you know, every year we'd have this conference and Magic would be there. And I've heard this damn story so many times, because he loves telling the Dream Team practice story. Like, this is in his, like, top five Magic stories. His Magic has, like, a list of stories he'll cycle through every year. And one of them was the Dream Team practice story. And this is the first time I really sat and watched the video of it. But,
So as soon as he started talking about practice, you knew what was coming.
Oh, I knew. Yeah, I was like, oh, I've heard this. you know, the fact that this is another situation where, you know, the fact that they still have this footage and was able to highlight some of the back and forth trash talking between the two of them. The thing I found hilarious, though, was, like, and this just seems to be very much who Magic Johnson is, but, like, his trash talking was, like, PG. Like, he was not cussing and, like...
Right.
He was very much, like, keeping it clean, but also, like, trying to...
He's like Philip Rivers. Yes. yeah, like, I... Because I'd heard the stories, too, you know, because I think... I want to say when I moved to San Diego, it was a few years. It was probably 94, 95. And so people were still like, you know, when the Dream Team had their practices out in L.A. and in San Diego before they went over to Barcelona, like people that were there at the time would still tell the stories of the, you know, the guys showing up and the practices and stuff like that. And the, like you talk to a janitor at one university and he's like, oh man, I seen Magic and Larry and Michael and they were just going back and forth. It was the greatest game I ever saw and it wasn't even a game. And then so to see like the actual participants talking about it was a cool thing for me. What wasn't cool, old Marcus Vandenberg, is the way they did that man, Tony Demetrius Kukoc.
Yeah, so
the disrespect
was a, you know, a guy from Europe that was drafted by the Bulls but was still playing overseas, and he really had his first exposure to the world during the 92 Olympics as part of the Croatia team, and of course it all goes back to Jerry Krause because, you know, that's where Jordan's hate comes from. And, you know, Krause was very high on Kukoc, and this was during, you know, Pippen's whole, he wants more money, but they were eyeing Kukoc to bring him over. So, you know, Pippen and Jordan essentially told the rest of the team when they played Croatia, like, leave him for us. We'll take care of him. And, you know, Tony gets, I would say, ambushed, and
yeah.
He realized, you know, he would have this all this special attention on the court.
They did that man dirty.
Yeah, they
like even like 2020 Tony Kukoc or 2019, whenever they sat down with him, he was still like, "I this is the first time I'd met them, and I did not know what was going on, and I did not know what was going on in Chicago, and they just came after me." like this nigga just came from a war. And this how you do him?
Kukoc is he's a better man than me because he was, you know, he handled it pretty well.
Yeah,
even talking about it now.
Yeah, I would have been hot about that.
Yeah,
but the thing I like about the documentary though is they did show in the gold medal game how he came back though. So it was like, and even Michael was like, you know, I earned respect for him in the gold medal game.
Yeah, and I mean, and then you know, Kukoc comes over. So Jordan retires in 93. Kukoc's first year is 93-94.
Mm-hmm.
And he's around for Jordan's second run with the Bulls. And, you know, I think Tony had a fine career. Like, he was probably someone ahead of his time in terms of what his game was. And, you know, if he was playing now, like, Tony would be a perfect stretch five. Of a guy who had some size, who could shoot the three, who could dribble.
Pass.
Yeah, to pass. So he sort of laid the foundation of what was to come from European players. But yeah, that was add Tony to the list of players that were sort of fueled by Michael. And there's one more in this documentary, in this episode that... actually, I think it might be episode 6 where they touch on. But... they win gold medal, obviously, and then Jordan, being a Nike guy, did not want to display the Reebok logo after winning gold during the ceremonies, and he covered the logo up with American flag.
Like where him and is it him and Ahmad Rashad in the car?
Yeah,
and he's talking about
a newspaper.
Yeah, and he's like, man, they still talking about this damn Reebok deal.
Yeah.
Like, Mike was hot about that. Like, he was not trying to show Reebok any love.
Not at all. And, you know, if this happens in today's climate, oh, my God. Could you imagine?
Could you imagine if LeBron did that? Like, it would be a wrap between certain segments of the population. Like, you saw what they did to Kaepernick. And imagine, he's out there using the flag as a prop.
Yeah. I mean, how dare you disrespect the flag? by covering up this logo. So, yeah, that was the Dream Team. And we go from there to the Republicans buy sneakers.
Oh, yeah.
Controversy. Yep.
Speaking of that percentage of the audience.
Yes.
This right here, Marcus Vandenberg, was, again, I've heard the quote many times over the years and didn't know, like, whether it was real or not, whether Michael was serious or not. And you know, he kind of talks about it here in the documentary of what was actually, you know, he says he was just kind of playing around. He was just kind of joking, making a flipping comment, but people didn't take it that way.
Yeah, this is always one of those stories which I thought might have been an urban legend. I mean, urban myth. Like, mm-hmm. I never knew if it was true or not or what the context was. And then when you hear about the context, which was the North Carolina Senate race in 1990, yep. Harvey Gantt, which was a black Democrat from North Carolina, was running against Jesse Helms, who... Google Jesse Helms if you don't know who Jesse Helms is. That's enough attention for him. And Jordan's mom wanted him to support Harvey Gantt. And Jordan was like, I don't know that man like that, but I'll put some on his books for him. And, you know, I'll keep him moving. And somehow this all ties back into the Republicans buy sneakers too. Mm-hmm. And Jordan will, in his documentary, confess that, you know, he never thought of himself as an activist. He thought of himself as a basketball player.
Yeah.
And if you weren't comfortable with that, then maybe I wasn't the right guy for you. Which, you know what? That's I appreciate the honesty.
Yeah. Like I'm not going to say what you should or should not do with your talent, right? With your position. You know, everybody's got to make that choice for themselves. I prefer when black athletes are more outspoken, like a Jim Brown, you know, like a Muhammad Ali, obviously, like a Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. Or if you want to bring it to the day, like as much crap as LeBron James gets, like he's been one of the more outspoken professional athletes of our time, and that's mm-hmm. something that I respect LeBron for. And so, yeah, like I'm disappointed that Mike didn't step up during an era where his voice could have been needed. But if that's not who this guy is, you know, it's not up to us to say he should have been that guy. You know, he should have been out there fighting for us. Granted, he probably should have listened to his mama. Because every time in this documentary that Mr. Lawrence says something and Mike does it, it comes up on the plus side. But this one time, he's like, nah, I can't do that. I'm not going to be able to do. And we saw how people reacted to it.
And that's where I see more similarities between him and Kobe in that sense. Kobe was not someone who was going to put himself out there for anything that was, you know, super political. And you know, I'm sure if you asked him, like, he wasn't that guy. And again, I respect that. Like, there's already enough pressure as is to be a public figure, a superstar athlete, and then on top of that, you're now expected to have an opinion on X, Y, and Z when who knows if you're even informed of those topics.
It's something that also, Marcus, like, unfortunately, unfairly gets applied to black athletes.
Yeah.
More so than anybody else. Because when something happens with white folks, and I'm generalizing here, but when something happens with white folks, like, Peyton Manning doesn't have to be the spokesman for all white people, right? Tom Brady doesn't have to be the spokesman for everybody that's white and going through something in the world. You know, J.J. Watt. I don't know why I'm sticking with football here. J.J. Watt doesn't have to be the spokesperson. Your man, Mike Trout, doesn't have to be the spokesperson for all white people. But when it comes to issues that affect the African-American community, unfortunately, it feels like, yeah, like Marshawn Lynch can't just speak for Marshawn Lynch, even though he does. Marshawn Lynch has got to be somebody that speaks for everybody, for the community as a whole. And it's an unfair position that we put these folks in a lot of times.
Yeah. So
Again, that's like when guys like LeBron and D. Wade and people like that step up. I think that's something to be commended because, honestly, as much as I say, you know, that as much as I'd like to thank Marcus, if I were in their position, I would be, you know, speaking out against police brutality or speaking out against Trump and all this other stuff. I don't know, man. You know, because money can change you. You know what I'm saying? So if I had that type of money and that type of talent, I might not be as outspoken as I'd like to think I would.
Money and just, I mean, just the extra attention. Like, they get enough sort of shit as it is.
Yep.
Let alone without having, you know, taking a stance. And that we've seen episode 6 that sort of drives Jordan to retirement the first time. It's just like he's just over it. Like, he's over the attention. He's over the media. He feels like he can't win because they're going to find something to sort of attack him for. That's asking a lot for someone on top of that just to take a stance on something. And then knowing that how this country still operates in 2020, let alone 1990, mm-hmm. like that would have been a huge story.
Just ask Colin Kaepernick. I'm trying to think anything else in five before we go to six.
Five ends with just about all the celebrities at the end of five that were trying to see Jordan during his last season, including the Georgia Dome. We got a Georgia Dome cameo, which took place on my birthday in 1988, which was the largest crowd for an NBA game ever. Bulls Hawks, I think it was 62,000 or something like that.
That's crazy.
Which, 2 months earlier, Georgia Dome.
Yep.
Goldberg.
That's what I was hoping. I was hoping when we went to the Georgia Dome, I was like, oh, I just need to see Goldberg just pop up. Goldberg and Jordan. Yeah. I think that was kind of the overall message of episode five is how big Jordan had become, not only as a player, but as a brand, as an icon. And that leads us into episode six, like you're saying, Marcus, where Michael starts to kind of brace against the pressure of all that attention and all that scrutiny to mm-hmm. be quite honest with it.
Yeah. So episode six, sort of starts with Michael trying to, you know, essentially dodge the media and just, you know,
just chilling on a sofa with a cigar.
Yes. Fuck your couch. MJ smoking in someone's hotel room.
Like even back then, I don't know if that was something,
sir,
you could do.
You can't do this, sir. This is not
this
allowed.
Is the Best Western.
Yes. That's how it starts. And then they talk about Jordan's gambling. That's like one of the bit themes out of this episode.
Yeah.
Where actually before that, Jordan Rose comes up. They sort of allude to Jordan being a gambler within, you know, teams and, you know, playing cards and stuff on the flights and stuff. And this is where we get the best shroud from the 90s from Jordan's security guard who beat him playing quarters. if you haven't seen this man, he's now a meme. Rest in peace. He died earlier this year, but
oh, really? Oh,
yeah,
man.
He had cancer. But I think Michael was paying him to the very end, so.
That's cool, yeah. It looked like they had a decent relationship.
Yeah.
Is this where we get everybody saying that Horace was the snitch?
Yes. So they talked about the Jordan Rules, which is a Sam Smith book that came out in, I think, 92, I want to say. I remember reading elementary school.
I was going to say, it was a big,
it was a bit, I mean, for sports fans,
big
it was
deal.
A huge deal. And you got to remember, this was a time where there was no internet, really. There was no social media, for sure. Probably no message boards in 92. So you got a certain level of information from newspapers and talk radio, but this book really peeled back the curtain of this is what's going on within this team and within this locker room. So the access that Sam had as a beat writer in Chicago, and then on top of that, when you found out that Jordan, who was presented as at the time sort of like this perfect superstar athlete, was also he was, you know, problematic. Not in a legal sense, or he was breaking the law. He was just not an angel. Let's put it like that.
Yeah. He is who we now know he is.
Yes. He's a very petty, competitive man.
Kind of a jerk sometimes.
Yes. Might punch you in the face.
Might punch you in the face. He'll call you short and fat to your face with no compunction.
Yeah.
And I think like one of my favorite lines early on in this episode is because everybody is saying Horace, like definitively Horace did it, because I guess him and Sam Smith were cool.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody's like, it had to be Horace, had to be Horace. Yeah, it was definitely Horace. And then BJ Armstrong, Senator Armstrong here is like, you know, I'm not saying it was Horace because, you know, there's a lot of stuff in that book that one person couldn't just say. So I'm not going to say it was just Horace. Like, okay. Like, and then Horace is like, I ain't say nothing, man.
Yeah, I mean, Jordan straight up said Horace was someone who...
Horace was the mole.
He was the leech. I agree with BJ that for a project of this size, it was more than just one player.
Yeah.
It was multiple people that were feeding information. And maybe Horace was the biggest name of the group, but it wasn't just Horace. Allegedly.
No, couldn't have been. Bushler had to tell at least two or three stories.
Yeah. But yeah, so that was, you know, Horace went from straight up bitches to now being labeled as a mole by Jordan.
He went from bitches to snitches.
Yes, pretty much.
Oh, and is this where, okay, so now we're talking about the Jordan rules. Is this where we're introduced to maybe my favorite side character of this episode? Eazy-E on the golf course?
Slim Bouler, yeah, so.
Slim Bouler!
This leads us to the 93 Eastern Conference Finals, which, as a kid who obviously rooted for Jordan, but also at this time had a special attachment to the Knicks because I spent a lot of time in New York as a kid. I love John Starks. I was sort of rooting for the Knicks here to beat Jordan, but we know how that ended. But this conference finals was a huge, at the time, conference finals between the two teams. And the Knicks, being the Knicks, somehow take the 2-0 series lead. And in between games 1 and 2, Jordan travels to Atlantic City to, quote, blow off some steam, a.k.a. gamble. And he comes back, and this doesn't come out until after the fact, but, you know, if you believe Jordan, Jordan says he was back by 12:31 and that, you know, he didn't drive. So what's the big deal? New York Times had him back at, like, you know, 2:30. Either way, they lost game 2, which probably wasn't a good look, but it didn't matter ultimately. But this takes us into Jordan's gambling, and a story that I had forgot about, which David Aldridge told us, was Jordan was attached to this guy Slim Bouler, who, as Nate described him, looked like Eazy-E on the golf course. Who was a convicted felon. And Jordan, actually, which I did not remember or know about, he skipped the White House in 91 when they won and was golfing with Slim Bouler instead. Jordan, this all comes out because Jordan writes a check for, I think, $58,000 that he owed Slim Bouler from gambling. And Slim Bouler ends up getting caught up and the legal system again. And this check comes out in court, and Jordan gets deposed and has to, you know, say, like, you know, what's this check about? And Jordan denies it at first, and then eventually comes clean to, you know, admit, yeah, I lost this money gambling. So
it's like, if you get jammed up, don't mention my name.
Yeah. So there's also another story with Jordan gambling with this guy, who is a former, I think, manager of the San Diego Sports Arena. And I guess they had some pretty high stakes golf games as well. And this guy ended up writing a book at the time as well. So, you know, basically this whole thing is wrapped up as like, look, and I think this is where they interviewed David Stern before he died and said, we looked into it. Jordan had money. Jordan was good for it. It was like, it was okay with us. So,
And like one of the things Michael says in the documentary, and I can't remember if it was at the time Michael or if it was current day 2020 Michael, where he's like, you know, I didn't do back. Basically, he's like, I didn't do background checks on these guys. You know,
That was current Michael.
Okay, so current Michael, he's like, you know, I these were just guys I competed against. You know, these were guys that I gambled with. You know, I didn't look into, you know, what type of people they were. And to me, that feels like, obviously Michael Jordan, we know, is a competitive dude. But to me, that feels like naive of Mike at the time to not be like, something's up with this dude, with this Jerry Curl on this golf course. Maybe I need to do some looking into this cat's background, knowing who he might be and who I am.
Yes. The Athletic did a story on Slim before all this was introduced in the documentary, that if you want to check that out to see what he's up to these days. But poor judgment in who you're gambling with.
So I think that's what we need. The next 30 for 30 should be just Slim. See, at the time, you know, I was in between my incarcerations, and I seen Mike on the golf course, and I was like, I could make a quick $50,000 right now.
He looked like Slick.
Yes, Reverend Slick from the WWE. Yes. As a golfer.
Yes.
And then we go to, basically we go to like a series of interviews where Mike is talking to Ahmad Rashad. I think he's talking to Barbara Walters at one point. And basically they're asking him about these gambling problems and these rumors and allegations of him spending all his money gambling. And it's a Jordan that, for the first time in this documentary, like, we see a Jordan that doesn't feel confident, right? We see a Jordan that doesn't feel like he's in charge of the situation. And you know, like the way he responds to Ahmad, and he's got those big thick sunglasses on, which Ahmad's like, I told him he shouldn't have worn them damn glasses. or when Barbara's like, you know, Michael, don't you think you owe the world an apology? And Michael Jordan of all people, Marcus Vandenberg, is just kind of sitting there sheepishly on his couch talking to Barbara Walters.
Yeah, this was sort of the beginning of the end for...
It was Barbara, right? Well, was it Diane Sawyer?
Was it Connie Chung? No, not Connie Chung.
Was it Connie?
No. Nah, I can't remember.
Connie was in the documentary. So okay. It was Connie Chung. Maybe it was her. Yeah. I knew it was either her, Barbara, or Diane Sawyer. Those were the three hot ones in the 90s when you did your interview. Oprah wasn't quite that big yet.
No. So, yeah, this was, I mean, if they'll touch on, I think, episode 7, that when Jordan really knew he was going to retire, but this felt like if he was on the fence leading up to this, like, the 93 playoff run was, like, you know, the deciding factor, and then ultimately when his dad died, that was really it. So
And how crazy is that, Marcus? Like, how crazy is it that you've got Jordan at arguably, like, he might be older, or he definitely was older at the time, but he was still in his peak, right? He was still at his prime.
Oh yeah, early 30s.
Yeah, and he's thinking about walking away for good. You know, obviously we know what happens, but like, just that he would be thinking that at that time is crazy to me.
Yeah. So the media outrage around gambling leads to Jordan not speaking to the media for a good chunk of the playoffs, and he breaks the silence with his main man, Ahmad Rashad. I think before game.
Yeah, Ahmad got a lot of run in these episodes.
He did. And that's where you got the Ray Charles glasses and, you know, Jordan says, hey, man, I don't have a problem. All right.
I don't have a problem with gambling. Gambling has a problem with me, baby.
Yeah, he wasn't very good at it either.
He's like, come on. He's like a gator in Jungle Fever. He's like, Michael, where's the TV? I gambled away the TV, mama.
I smoked the TV, mama.
You know I do it.
I do it. Great movie.
Yes, great movie. Check out Jungle Fever, ladies and gentlemen. Spike Lee, who was in this documentary, directed it.
Yes. So yeah, that he breaks the silence, and that leads us to the 93 finals, where somehow Dan Marley, of all people, is a Jerry Krause guy. Once Jordan finds out that Krause is a fan for Dan Marley.
The pettiness of Michael Jordan. He's like,
Pete Jordan Petty is coming in episode 8, where I would just mention the name, LeBradford Smith. If you don't know that story, that is ultimate Pete Michael
Jordan. I haven't heard that name in years. but just the way Michael's like, you know, Jerry thought that he could be the new me. Like, he sounds like David Ruffin in The Temptations. Ain't nobody coming to see you, Otis.
Yeah.
Like, ain't nobody coming to see you, Thunder Dan.
Yeah. Thunder Dan was Otis. And Otis got handed to him in game one.
like all these people out here, Tony Kukoc, Dan Marley, taking beatings because of Jerry Krause.
I know. Man. So yeah, just the end of it, episode 6 touches on the 93 finals, and you know, the Suns put up a pretty good fight against Chicago. Yeah. Barkley.
People forget how good Barkley was year.
Barkley was a beast.
And again, Petty Mike, Barkley won the MVP, and Mike was like, all right, I got you, fam. Even though we friends, I got you.
Do you know who finished second in that MVP race? It wasn't Mike.
Let's see. So you're talking 93? 93. Give me the conference.
Western Conference.
Western Conference? Okay. I'm going to say Karl Malone.
Hakeem Olajuwon.
Oh, the Dream.
Mm-hmm.
Damn. So Hakeem and Charles finished. Charles won it, and then Hakeem finished second. Michael was third?
Yeah.
Damn.
Yeah. So yeah, that leads us to game 6, where we get the John Paxson 3-pointer to win the series. And I think if he doesn't hit that 3, I think game 7's, you know, a total crapshoot at that point, especially with that game being in Phoenix. That maybe that was the end of the Bulls' run without John Paxson.
Mm-hmm. And maybe Michael does retire off of that loss.
Yeah.
But yeah, like, and again, I think people, because most people now, especially younger folks, Marcus, they know Charles Barkley for the TV personality of Charles. Mm-hmm. You know, inside the NBA or doing the Capital One commercials with Sam Jackson and Spike Lee. But they forget, man, Charles Barkley was a beast out here. Like, just at his size to be the type of rebounder and defender that he was. And then he also could shoot the 3, right? Like, Charles had some offense with him.
Yeah. I mean, the whole Draymond comparisons that he really thinks he's on par with Barkley. It's just laughable.
it's not even close. So yeah, the Bulls win another series, and I think what this episode as well as the previous episode, Marcus, because, you know, you had kind of going back to the Dream Team when they had that practice. I think Magic was the one who said it, that, like, Michael showed like he was a step above everybody else. And so we've got Michael on this pedestal, like in a room full of greats, he's the greatest. Mm-hmm. And Charles is like, you know, never in my life did I think that anybody was better than me. Then I played Michael Jordan, and I was like, he's just better than me. And like, Charles is like, the MVP is like, yeah, that guy's better than me. I did my best, and he still was better than me. And so you're getting this kind of appreciation for the competitor and the player that Mike was.
And unfortunately, those two are not on good terms.
Mike and Charles?
No, Barkley would end up criticizing his Hornets run.
Oh, you know, yeah.
And,
wow.
Barkley in this documentary wasn't himself. He didn't feel like Charles Barkley. He felt like, I don't know. Maybe he was sort of thinking about the friendship and sort of what happened and stuff. But yeah, they're not tight at the moment.
That's crazy. Yeah,
I don't think these Isaiah Thomas level, but yeah, they're not close.
Yeah, I was gonna say, because they were back in the day, they were really tight.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
and now it's like. Like, and that makes a lot of sense then, because Charles did the after show on ESPN with Scott Van Pelt. Mm-hmm. And Van Pelt talked to Charles for about 10-15 minutes, and Charles was like saying all the right things, but it didn't feel like his heart was in it, if that makes any sense.
Yeah.
Like, he was talking about how good Mike was and the battles that they had and the time with the Dream Team, but it didn't feel like there was like joy behind it. Like, he wasn't his usual self, like he's saying.
I mean, maybe this documentary / the pandemic will sort of get those two to make up. I mean, yeah. So, yeah, that's how episode 6 ends.
Yes, yep, episode 6. And then we got the preview for episode 7, that night on ESPN, which is basically, I don't know if you ever read comics, Marcus, but back in the 90s, they had the story where Superman was killed. And then, like, the next year of comics was basically about who's going to fill the vacuum with our Superman. And that's, like, the tease we got. Like, Jordan retires, and then you get these clips of Scotty. And then all of a sudden, it's like, but is he coming back? And that's the hook that they leave us with.
Yeah, so they'll touch on the baseball run. They'll touch on the death of his father, who was murdered. They'll touch on the 94 Bulls, which was the year without Jordan around, and sort of how that played out. And then
how Scotty punked out in that Knicks series and had to save him.
Exactly. So they'll talk about the Scotty Pippen twitting on his team for all the new Scotty stands. Well, you might want to get off the bandwagon now.
Right. That was the time. You know, so you buy low, you sell high. Because, I remember that like clear as day, Marcus, because that season, and I'm sure we'll talk about it more next week, but like that season was all about kind of, we're going to make Scott, and I don't want to say this in a disrespectful way, because Scotty obviously was a great player, but it was kind of like, we're going to make Scotty the new Mike. You know, I think he was the All-Star Game MVP that year. Like, he was balling. But then in the playoffs, it's a lot different being the number two guy to being the number one guy. And Scotty, to me, kind of faded a little bit, particularly in that game where he decided to quit on the team.
Yeah, that was – yeah. They'll dive into that next week. And then episode 8 will – sort of pick up with the 97 playoffs, which was Charlotte, Chicago, which featured BJ Armstrong, now a Hornet. And, speaking of petty Mike, you know, BJ caught the fade from Mike on the court.
Damn. Not BJ. That man ain't nothing but 14 years old.
Amen. He had to get it too. They'll talk about LeBradford Smith, who. The ultimate petty Michael Jordan story. And then Jordan's return to basketball and sort of like why the baseball strike was a factor in Jordan coming back. And then we get, you know, the double nickel game at the Garden. We get Jordan's return in Indiana.
I'm trying to think, because did they talk Space Jam? Because I think that would have been around that time.
Space Jam's episode 8 as well. They talked about filming the movie and trying to get back into shape from playing baseball, and the infamous Jordan Dome, which they set up for Jordan, and how all these NBA players came by to play, pick up with Jordan. And then the Steve Kerr fight in practice. Both sides. Both men tell their stories. And then the 96 finals, which features Jordan on the iPad reacting to Gary Payton. That's all I'll say. So
okay, we got another meme coming.
Not a meme, just, you know, Jordan P. Jordan. not letting shit go all these years later.
That's the one constant that we've seen through all these episodes so far. Like, Mike will carry a grudge to the grave.
Yes.
He is Deontay Wilder to this day.
To this day.
That's episodes 5 and 6 of The Last Dance. Next week we'll be back with episodes 7 and 8. So we've only got 2 more weeks of this thing, Marcus. It's kind of flown by.
I mean, yeah, it's... We're already 3 weeks in, and it sounds like episode 10 is not even done yet. So
that's what I was going to say, because the last I heard from Air is they were still working on 10. So it's like, y'all ain't got a lot of time.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, here's the thing maybe we can talk about once it's over, Marcus, but I'll just put this out there now, because I've enjoyed, like, pretty much everything about this documentary, but I'm wondering, could it have been even better if, because, you know, most documentaries, they take, you know, the year to film it or whatever, and then they take a long time afterwards to, you know, polish it up, get it right, screen it, all this other stuff. As good as it is, I wonder, you know, could it have been better had they had, you know, the time to wait until the summer when they were originally supposed to release it?
I mean, you got to factor in the pandemic too, because I think that's one of the factors where they were still chasing interviews when all those, when the country went, you know, shut down. So,
we could have got that hot 30 minute sit down with Slim Bouler.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know how much better they could have improved on. That's a tough question.
I'll say it's going to be like one of those what ifs. But again, like, I've liked everything that they've done so far. Like, even the first night, which I felt was a little bit slow, everything's been good. So, like, yeah, there's a reason why people are still invested in this. And I think, like, the first retirement and the return is going to be something that a lot of folks who were too young to remember at the time are going to be talking about, and then, you know, baseball and all this other stuff. So it'll be fun the next couple of weeks.
I mean, I remember when that happened as a kid. When I don't remember the retirement. I remember the comeback with the facts, and, you know, coming back to Indiana. I'm back and wearing 45.
Wearing 4 or 5.
Yeah.
So, and Jay-Z was like, oh, I could put that in a rhyme one day. Mm-hmm. So, Marcus Vandenberg, where can the people find you on these social media streets if they want to talk to you about their experiences hearing the Magic Johnson story, or if Slim Bouler wants to reach out and get an exclusive interview and give you an exclusive interview at Yahoo?
You can find me at Marco Will, MarcoWill. Speaking of Magic, he used to tell us he had the story, or not the story, but just this sort of go-to line when it came to, because this conference was co-ed, so we were in a hotel. He didn't want, you know, any extra activities going on, so he would have this whole, make this whole speech about he wants none of this and none of that going on in the room. So, He was a trip, man.
Shout out to Magic. Shout out to your man Irvin Magic Johnson, who was great at everything except for hosting talk shows.
They say never meet your heroes, but he's actually, you know, a pretty stand up dude. So
okay, he sounds like it. Like, I obviously never met Magic, but from all the people that I've watched and heard stories told about him and hearing you tell stories, he seems like a good dude.
Yeah.
So I mean, again, like that talk show, that wasn't Magic's fault.
Oof, the Magic Hour.
The Magic Hour with Sheila E. That was the best part of that show, Sheila E. and the band.
Man. Yeah, that was between that and his coaching career, I don't know what was worse.
Oh, yeah, I forgot all about the coach. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was grand opening, grand closing.
Oh, it was real quick.
Was that with the Nick Van Exel team?
Yep.
And Peeler?
Anthony Peeler. I think Eldon Campbell still. Vladdy was still there, I think.
Vladdy was there because that was the big story. Like, now that they went from teammates to now he's coaching Vladdy.
Yeah.
Because he used to always get on Vladdy. And
he didn't last a quarter of a season before he got fired. Mm-hmm.
Yes, the Lake Show.
Yes.
That was the Lake Show era. that's a team that's not on my NBA 2K20 markets, but, you know, they got, like, greatest teams.
Uh-huh.
Like, where's my Lake Show Lakers with Coach Magic Johnson on the sideline?
Not included.
I want to use Sadale Threet. you can find me on Twitter at @8, MOZAIK, @ Nate Mosaic. Check out Patreon. You're watching, so you already know where it is. But for those listening, patreon.com/kingsofsport. Rocky Mavia Picture Show over at Post Wrestling, which we have a shirt out now, store.postwrestling.com. Chris from LA was modeling his shirt the other day, Marcus, on his latest video podcast. So
okay.
Shout out to Chris rocking the Rocky Mavia Picture Show swag. And we got a new episode of Black Lightning Podcast coming out this week where we started trying to talk about how production for a lot of these CW shows is up in the air right now. And it ended up being 10 minutes about that, Marcus, and 40 minutes of four black people who are frustrated with the leadership in America. Oh. And that's all I'll say about that.
All right.
So you can check that out at the DCTV Podcast Network. So unless you got anything else, Marcus, we're going to tie a bow on this episode, and we'll be back next week for the next installment of our Last Dance series.
Happy Mother's Day in advance.
Yes, happy Mother's Day. Shout out to all the mothers out there.
To my mom and my wife, who stopped listening to the show years ago. Yes.
Yes, happy, you know what? As a matter of fact, I'm going to put in, because we haven't done this for a couple of years, Marcus, because I don't know, like, how our schedules have been around Mother's Day, but I'm going to play the Mr. T Mother's
right.
Day, the speech and the rap, you know, talking about how great mothers are, treat your mothers right, because every day should be Mother's Day.
Yes.
On Arbor Day, it was Mother's Day. On President's Day, it was Mother's Day. So, yeah, if you hadn't seen that, don't worry, because we finna play that clip for you along with the rap song. But yeah, shout out to all the mothers out there. Shout out to my mom. Shout out to my sister. You know, shout out to Dolores Jordan, because we wouldn't even be here talking this week, Marcus, if it wasn't for Dolores Jordan.
Shout out to her moisturizer, because her skin is immaculate, man.
Yes, yes.
It is. It is stunning.
She is taking care of herself quite well.
Yes.
So shout out to you, Ms. Jordan. But yeah, that's going to do it. Thank you for listening. Thank you for checking out the show. And we'll be back next week with an all-new episode of the world's most dangerous podcast, The Kings of Sport. So, for Marcus Vandenberg, for Michael Jordan, and for Mr. T, I am the Godfather Nate Milton. Remember to treat your mother right, everybody. Because you've been down with the Kings.
Because I wanted my mother to know how much she meant to me. I wanted my mother to know how much that I love her. I wanted my mother to know that I love her every day, and not just on her birthday, not just on Mother's Day, not just on Valentine's Day or Christmas Day, but I love my mother on President's Day. I love my mother on Election Day, on Labor Day, Independence Day, Columbus Day, Earth Day, Memorial Day, Flag Day, Groundhog's Day, April Fool's Day, New Year's Day, St. Patrick's Day, and yes, even on Father's Day, I love my mother.
That's all for this week's edition of the Kings of Sport. Be sure to come back next week for an all-new episode. You can leave feedback for the show on Twitter at KOS_POD or via Gmail at thekingsofsport@gmail.com. Don't forget to like and rate us on iTunes and tell a friend. The Kings of Sport is a production of the Mosaic Podcast Network.
Whether you like it or not, he's bad. D-A-double-D-Y-X-X.
What in the wide, wide world of sports is going on here?
Let me tell you something, Mean Gene. I'm going to go out there and I'm going to leave it all on the mat. Because that's what I do when I get it done so I can do